Bijak Kimia. Tajuk perbincangan kali ini adalah soalan percubaan PSPM 1 KMK set 1. Kertas kimia DK014 dijadualkan pada 13 Disember 2021 hari Isnin pada pukul 2.30 sehingga 3.30 petang selama 1 jam. Pelajar perlu menjawab 30 soalan objektif. Berikut merupakan topik yang terlibat dalam kertas kimia DK014. Chapter 1 Matter, Chapter 2 Atoms, Molecules and Ions, Chapter 3 Mole Concept, Chapter 4 Chemical Equation and Stoichiometry, Chapter 5 Electronic Configuration, Chapter 6 Periodic Table, Chapter 8 Chemical Equilibrium and Chapter 9 Reaction Kinetics. Question 1. A cup of sugar crystal is dissolved in hot water. Which statements are true? Satu cawan gula dalam bentuk kristal telah dilarutkan dalam air panas. Pernyataan manakah yang benar? For this question, students need to understand the concept about elements, compound, homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. We start with elements and compound. Elements contain of only one kind of atom. Unsur terdiri daripada satu jenis atom sahaja. As for example, helium atom and oxygen molecule O2. Contohnya, atom helium dan molecule oxygen O2. Compounds contain of two or more kind of atoms. As for example, compound of water, H2O. As we can see here, water consists of different atoms, hydrogen and oxygen atom. Sebatian terdiri daripada dua ataupun lebih atom-atom yang berbeza. Contohnya, sebatian air H2O yang terdiri daripada dua jenis atom yang berbeza, iaitu atom hydrogen dan atom oxygen. Next, sugar is an organic compound that consists of three different atoms, carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. Thus, sugar is compound. Next is mixture. There are two types of mixture, heterogeneous and homogeneous. Terdapat dua jenis campuran, iaitu campuran homogeneous dan campuran heterogeneous. Now we study the example. If we have two components and we mix those components, as for example, the component of sand plus component of water, since the sand not dissolved in water, so both components will exist in different phase, which is solid and liquid. So this type of mixture known as heterogeneous mixture. Memandangkan dua komponen pasir dan air tidak larut antara satu sama lain dan kedua-dua komponen wujud dalam fasa yang berbeza, iaitu pasir dalam keadaan pepejal manakala air dalam keadaan liquid. Dua fasa yang berbeza merujuk kepada campuran heterogeneous. Next, if we have a situation, we have two components of sugar and water. Since sugar dissolves in water, so we have a mixture of same phase, which is aqueous solution. So this mixture known as homogeneous mixture. Bagi contoh yang kedua, jika ada dua komponen yang bercampur, dalam kes ni adalah gula dan juga air. Gula larut dalam air, oleh itu ia akan membentuk satu larutan iaitu aqueous solution. Jadi memandangkan kedua-dua komponen wujud dalam fasa yang sama iaitu aqueous, campuran ini dikenali sebagai homogeneous mixture. So the answer is forms homogeneous mixture. The correct statements are 2 and 3. Extra information about pure substances and mixtures. Question 2. Pure water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. What happens to the water particles when water boils? Air mendidih pada suhu 100 darjah Celsius. Apakah yang berlaku kepada zarah-zarah air apabila air mendidih? First, they lose energy and move further apart. Zarah-zarah kehilangan tenaga dan bergerak menjauhi antara satu sama lain. Second, they lose energy and stay close together. Zarah-zarah kehilangan tenaga dan mendekati antara satu sama lain. Third, they gain energy and stay close together. Zarah-zarah mendapat tenaga dan mendekati antara satu sama lain. Fourth, They gain energy and move further apart. Zarah-zarah mendapat tenaga dan bergerak menjauhi antara satu sama lain. Boiling process involve the change in liquid phase into gas phase. Proses pendidihan melibatkan perubahan fasa cecair kepada fasa gas. In boiling process, the water molecule will absorb heat energy, as for example from the fire, and then the heat energy will be converted into kinetic energy. When the kinetic energy overcome the intermolecular forces within the molecules of water, and then the water molecules can escape as gas or water vapor. Dalam proses pendirihan, apabila dibekalkan dengan tenaga haba, molekul air akan menyerap tenaga haba tersebut. Kemudian tenaga haba tersebut akan ditukarkan kepada tenaga kinetik ataupun tenaga untuk pergerakan. Seterusnya, molekul air akan bergerak menjauhi antara satu sama lain. Seterusnya, apabila tenaga kinetik mengatasi daya tarikan antara molekul, barulah molekul air akan terbebas sebagai wap air ataupun molekul dalam fasa gas. Thus, the answer is they gain energy and move further apart. Question 3. Q2 plus is the ion of elements Q. What is the lowest value in the ion? Q2 plus adalah ion bagi unsur Q. Apakah nilai terendah bagi ion tersebut? Formation of ion. When neutral atom lose or remove electron, it will form cation. When neutral atom accept or gain electron, it will form anion. Apabila suatu atom yang neutral kehilangan elektron, ia akan membentuk ion yang bercas positif, iaitu cation. Manakala atom neutral yang menerima elektron akan membentuk ion bercas negatif atau anion. Q2 plus is cation. Example of cation is magnesium 2 plus ion. Magnesium 2 plus ion is formed when neutral atom magnesium lose 2 electron. As we can see here, magnesium 2 plus ion has less number of electron compared to its parent atom. Contoh cation adalah magnesium 2 plus ion. Ion magnesium 2 plus terbentuk apabila atom magnesium yang neutral kehilangan 2 elektron, membentuk ion yang bercas 2 positif. Di sini kita dapat lihat ion magnesium mempunyai jumlah elektron yang rendah berbanding atom magnesium. Same situation with formation of Q2 plus ion. The number of neutrons and number of proton inside the nucleus stay the same. To find nuclear number is the sum of number of neutrons and proton number. So its value also remain the same. As we can see here, Q2 plus ion has less number of electrons compared to its parent atom. Thus, the answer is the number of electrons. Question 4. Which statements about isotopes of the same elements are correct? Pernyataan manakah yang benar tentang isotopes bagi unsur yang sama? Isotopes are two or more atoms of the same elements that have same number of protons, but different number of neutrons in their nuclei. Isotopes adalah dua atau lebih atom-atom yang terdiri daripada unsur yang sama yang mempunyai bilangan proton yang sama tetapi bilangan neutron yang berbeza di dalam nukleus. For example, isotopes of carbon consists of three types: carbon 12, carbon 13, and carbon 14. All of these three isotopes have same number of protons. However, they have different number of neutrons and different nuclear number. Option 1. They are atoms which have the same chemical properties because they have the same number of electrons in their outer shell. Isotopes adalah atom-atom yang mempunyai sifat kimia yang sama kerana mereka mempunyai bilangan elektron yang sama di petala terluar. Option 2. They are atoms which have the same number of electrons and neutrons but different number of protons. Isotopes adalah atom-atom yang mempunyai bilangan elektron yang sama, bilangan neutron yang sama, Bilangan proton yang berbeza? Salah. Option 3. There are atoms which have the same number of electrons and protons but different number of neutrons. Isotopes adalah atom-atom yang mempunyai bilangan elektron yang sama banyak, bilangan proton yang sama banyak tetapi bilangan neutron berbeza. Thus, option 1 and 3 are correct. The answer is 1 and 3. Question 5. The empirical formula for fructose or fruit sugar is CH2O. If the molar mass of fructose is 180 g per mole, find the molecular formula for this sugar. Given molar mass of carbon, 12, hydrogen, 1, oxygen, 16. There is a formula that relates molecular formula and empirical formula. The formula is molecular formula equals to empirical formula times n. Thus, n is equal to molecular mass over empirical mass. We need to find n. Molecular mass already given in the question, so we can refer to the value of molar mass, which is 180 gram per mole. Since the empirical formula is already given in the question CH2, so we can find its mass. Carbon, the mass is 12. Hydrogen, the mass is 1, so 2 times 1. And then 1 oxygen, 1 times 16 is 16 gram per mole. Gram per mole, 180 over 30 is equal to 6. Thus, the molecular formula is N is 6, so carbon 6, hydrogen 12, oxygen 6. The answer is C6H12O6. Question 6. Which row about name of inorganic compounds is correct according to IUPAC nomenclature? Baris manakah yang benar bagi penamaan sebatian tak organik berdasarkan penamaan IUPAC? A, Ba2 plus boron ion, incorrect. This is not boron ion, it is barium ion. B, FeOH2, iron 2 hydroxide. 2, 1, FeOH, Fe is positive ion with the charge of 2. OH minus is negative ion with the charge of 1. Thus, iron 2, correct. Hydroxide ion, also correct. The answer is B. NH4Cl, nomenclature ammonia chloride, incorrect. The actual name is ammonium chloride. Cl minus, chlorine ion, incorrect. The correct name is chloride ion. Question 7. The atomic mass of magnesium is 24.3 amu. Which statement is false? Jisim atom bagi magnesium adalah 24.3 amu. Pernyataan manakah yang salah? Amu means atomic mass unit, correct? Value 24.3 is average mass of all isotopes of magnesium, correct? Nilai 24.3 adalah purata jisim bagi semua isotop bagi magnesium. Average atomic mass is the weighted average of the atomic masses of the naturally occurring isotopes of an element. Jisim atom merujuk kepada purata berat bagi jisim atom untuk isotopes bagi elemen tersebut. For example, isotope of magnesium consists of magnesium 24, 25 and 26. From the value of percentage abundance, magnesium 24 is the most abundant. To find the average atomic mass, we can use this formula. So, the average mass of these three isotopes are 24.3 amu. This is just example. No need to know the calculation for this formula. Next, value 24.3 is summation mass of protons, neutrons and electrons of magnesium. Incorrect. Nilai 24.3 adalah hasil tambah bagi jisim proton, neutron dan elektron. Pernyataan ini adalah tidak tepat. Value 24.3 is atomic mass of magnesium relative to 1/12 mass of an atom of carbon 12. This statement is correct. From the formula of AR, relative atomic mass, the average mass of one atom of the element over 1/12 the mass of carbon 12 atom. To find AR of magnesium, the mass of one magnesium atom is 24.3 amu per one 12 mass of one carbon 12 atom. So carbon 12, the mass is 12 AMU. AMU cancel AMU. So the AR value is 24.3. No unit. Reminder, atomic mass has unit AMU. Relative atomic mass has no unit. Thus, the answer is option 3. Question 8. Calculate the molarity of 83.47 milliliter sulfuric acid solution containing 27 gram of sulfuric acid, given molar mass of sulfuric acid 98 gram per mole. The solute is H2SO4, solvent is water H2O, and the solution is H2SO4 aqueous solution. The question asks to find molarity. The formula of molarity is mole of solute divide volume of solution in unit of liter or decimeter cube. From the question, we don't know the mole of solute yet, but we are given the mass of the solute 27 gram. So we can find the mole of solute H2SO4. The formula is mass over molar mass. The mass is 27 gram and the molar mass of H2SO4 is 98 gram per mole. The mole is 0.276. So, we insert the mole into the formula of molarity. Next is the volume of solution already given in question but in unit of ml. So, we convert into liter, divide by 1000. So, we get 0.08347 liter. So, we just insert the volume in liter in the formula of molarity and we get the final answer 3.3 mole per liter or M. So, the answer is 3.3 molar. Question 9. How do you make 500 milliliter of 0.7 molar HCl solution from stock solution of HCl with molarity 11.6 molar? Bagaimanakah cara untuk menyediakan larutan HCl dengan isi padu sebanyak 500 ml dan molarity atau kepekatan sebanyak 0.7 molar daripada larutan stok dengan molarity sebanyak 11.6 molar? This is the dilution process. Ini adalah proses pencairan. In dilution, a solution with higher concentration will be changed into a solution with lower concentration. Dalam proses pencairan, larutan dengan kepekatan tinggi atau larutan stok akan berubah menjadi larutan dengan kepekatan rendah ataupun larutan cair. The stock solution molarity is 11.6 molar. And then we add solvent, which is water, to get diluted HCl solution with volume of 500 ml and molarity of 0.7 molar. In dilution, the mole of solute before and after experiment is equal. Since the formula of molarity equals to mole of solute over volume of solution, so to find the mole is equal to the molarity times volume. Note that the unit of volume must be in unit of liter. Now, since the mole of solute before and after the process is equal, so the formula of dilution is M1V1 equals to M2V2. In this formula, the unit of volume can be in ml or L. The unit of volume, either in liter or milliliter, will not affect the final answer in this formula. Next, we insert the value for initial and final. M1 or the molarity of stock solution is equal to the 11.6 molar. Volume, we don't know. And then, molarity of the diluted solution is 0.7 molar. Volume, we already know, 500 ml. Thus, the final volume would be 30.17 ml or 30.2 ml. Thus, the answer is option 2. Question 10. Based on reaction equation given, 2 mol carbon monoxide react with 1 mol of oxygen gas to produce 2 mol of carbon dioxide gas. Calculate the mass of carbon dioxide CO2 produced from 14 gram of carbon monoxide CO. Given molar mass of carbon monoxide, oxygen and carbon dioxide. Now we are given the information about mass of reactant carbon monoxide, which is 14 gram. And then we need to find what is the mass of carbon dioxide. In this question, we need to do some stoichiometric calculation. Jadi untuk soalan ini, kita perlu membuat pengiraan stoichiometry, iaitu pengiraan yang berdasarkan persamaan kimia yang seimbang. We start with identify the mole of reactants CO because we are given the mole of CO. The formula of mole is mass over molar mass. The mass given is 14 gram and then the molar mass of carbon monoxide already given 28 gram per mole. Thus, the mole is 0.5 mole. Next, we do stoichiometry. So, we compare the mole of carbon monoxide with the mole of product CO2. From the balance equation, we understand that 2 mole of carbon monoxide produce 2 mole of carbon dioxide. So, if we have 0.5 mole of carbon monoxide, 0.5 divide 2 times 2. Okay, remember this value, divide by this value and then times this value. Thus, we get 0.5 mole of carbon dioxide. Next, we need to find the mass of carbon dioxide. So, from the formula mole mass over molar mass, to find the mass, equal to the mole time molar mass. The target is carbon dioxide. So, mole of carbon dioxide is 0.5 mole. And then the molar mass is 44 gram per mole. The final answer is 22 gram. So, the answer is option 1. Question 11. Water is added to ionic compound ferrous chloride FeCl2 to make a solution with molarity of 0.17 molar. Determine the concentration of chloride ion. Assume the volume is 1 liter. Aqueous solution is a solution which water is the solvent. Larutan aqueous adalah satu larutan di mana pelarutnya adalah molekul air H2O. Dalam soalan ini, kita ada larutan dengan pelarutnya water H2O dan solute zat terlarut FeCl2. Given molarity of solution is 0.17 molar. And the question asks us to identify what is the concentration of chloride ion. Okay, first, we must understand that ferrous chloride FeCl2 dissociates into Fe2 plus ion and chloride ion. Balance the equation. 1 ion, 1 ion, 2 chlorine, 2 chloride ion. Next, since the molarity of FeCl2 is 0.17 molar, thus concentration of 1 mole Fe2 plus ion also same, which is 0.17 molar. However, the concentration of chloride ion is 2 times based on the balance equation. Thus, we get the value of 0.34 molar. Thus, the answer is option 2, 0.34 molar. Question 12. The maximum number of electrons in an atom that can have the following set of 4 quantum numbers. N equals to 4, L equals to 2, M equals to negative 2, S equals to positive half. Jadi untuk soalan ini, pelajar perlu mengenal pasti berapakah jumlah elektron yang maksimum yang boleh diisi bagi set quantum number yang telah diberikan ini. Since we are given only one set of complete four quantum number. So one set represents one electron. Thus, the answer is option one, one electron. Remember, one electron can have only one set of four quantum numbers. Extra information, if n equals to 4, L value can be 0, 1, or 2, or 3. L value 0 represents orbital S, L value 1 represents orbital P, L value 2 represents orbital D, and L value 3 represents orbital F. Orbital S, orbital P, orbital D, orbital F. It means that the electron with this set of quantum number can be filled in one of these five orbital D. Question 13. Which statement below is true about orbital diagram? Pernyataan manakah yang benar tentang orbital diagram yang telah diberikan? We need to apply Hund's rule. Hund's rule states that in the orbitals of the same subshell, electrons are filled singly first before pairing starts. Peraturan Hund menyatakan bahawa dalam orbital-orbital yang sama aras tenaga ataupun sama subshell, elektron akan diisi satu demi satu terlebih dahulu sebelum dipasangkan. Misalnya pengisian elektron dalam orbital 2p. Jadi ada 4 elektron yang diisi, kita perlu isi satu demi satu terlebih dahulu pada spin yang sama, parallel spin. Kemudian ada baki, baru kita pair up, baru kita pasangkan dengan opposite spin, dengan spin yang berbeza. So this is the correct arrangement of electrons in the degenerate orbitals. Okay, the second orbital incorrect because in orbital 2p, the electrons are filled by pairing up first. Okay, so this one is incorrect. It is not allowed. Option 1, both arrows in the fill 2px box should be pointing the same direction. Okay, maksudnya dia kata dalam orbital 2p sepatutnya spin dia sama. Okay, jadi penyataan ni tidak benar. Option 2, there is nothing incorrect with this diagram. This one also incorrect because this orbital diagram is incorrect because it not follow the Hund's rule. Option 3. In the orbital diagram, there should be only one arrow in the first 2p box and one in the second 2p box in parallel spin. Jadi kalau ikut option ketiga ni, dia maklumkan dalam orbital 2p, sepatutnya ada satu sahaja anak panah pada kotak yang pertama dan pada kotak yang kedua ada satu anak panah dengan parallel spin, spin yang sama, iaitu kalau positif, dua-duanya positif. Kalau negatif, kedua-duanya negatif. Option 4. All the arrows should be pointing the same direction. Okay, jadi maksudnya dalam orbital 2P, dia kata sepatutnya dua anak panah tu menghala ke arah yang sama. Okey, jadi kalau tengok ayat, all maksudnya bukan setakat 2P, dalam 2S pun same spin, dalam 1S pun same spin. Jadi dalam kes ni yang betul adalah option yang ketiga sahaja. The answer is option 3. Question 14. Which one of the following is the electronic structure of a metal with a maximum oxidation state of positive 3? In the periodic table of elements, commonly, metal are arranged in the left side of table and then on the right side of table, mostly non-metal elements. And the metalloid is in the middle between the metal and non-metal. Jadi, kalau kita rujuk dalam jadual berkala, metal ataupun logam kebiasaannya akan berada di sebelah kiri jadual. Okay, so jadi kalau dalam image ini diwakili oleh warna biru. Manakala non-metal, unsur bukan logam akan terletak di bahagian sebelah kanan jadual, diwakili warna kuning. Sementara itu, metalloid yang diwakili dengan warna hijau akan berada di tengah-tengah antara metal dan non-metal. Metalloid adalah unsur yang mempunyai kedua-dua sifat logam dan bukan logam. Okey, jadi bila kita kata oxidation state positive 3, kemungkinan metal tersebut mungkin kumpulan 3 ataupun kumpulan 13. Okey, kerana positif 3 merujuk kepada ion yang terbentuk apabila atom buang 3 elektron valence. Okey, option 1, given SPDF notation or electronic configuration 1s2 2s2 2p6 3s1. So from this configuration we can understand that there is one valence electron here. So let's say we label this as A, B, C and D. So if this element form ion, the charge would be A positive 1. Okay, next B, based on this configuration, it has 1, 2, 3, okay? It has 3 valence electrons. So when B becomes ion, the oxidation state is 3 plus. Next is C. From the configuration, there are total 6 electron valence. So C will accept another 2 electron to form C2 minus, and D has 2 valence electrons, so D if forms ion D2 plus. Thus the species with oxidation number positive 3 is option 2. Question 15. How many unpaired electrons in mangan 2 plus ion? Berapakah jumlah elektron yang tak berpasangan dalam ion Mn2+. There are two types of electrons, unpaired electrons and paired electrons. If there are two electrons in one orbital, then the type of electrons are known as paired electron, electron yang berpasangan. If the electron is arranged only one in each of the orbital, so these 3 electrons known as unpaired electron, electron yang tak berpasangan. Okay, so to identify the unpaired electrons in mangan ion, we must start by writing its electronic configuration. Okay, mangan 25, so this is proton number, so it means that mangan has 25 number of protons and 25 number of electrons. So the configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d5. So when mangan become ion, okay, same proton number, but it will be less number of electron because 2 electron will be removed from the orbital. As thus, the new configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, no more 4s, and 3d5. So, if we write the orbital diagram for mangan 2+, we get this configuration. In orbital 1s, consists of 2 electrons, orbital 2s, also 2 electrons, and so on. So there are 5 electrons in orbital 3D. Thus, from this orbital diagram, we can identify there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 unpaired electrons. So the answer is option 4. There are 5 unpaired electrons. Question 16. Hydrogen and chlorine reacts as shown. What is the equation for this reaction? One molecule of hydrogen. The formula of hydrogen gas is H2. One molecule of chlorine. The formula of chlorine gas is Cl2. Two molecules of hydrogen chloride. The formula of hydrogen chloride is HCl. So, one molecule hydrogen, one molecule chlorine, and two molecule hydrogen chloride. So, the answer is option 3. One mole hydrogen react with one mole chlorine to form two mole of HCl. Question 17. Aluminium reacts with fluorine. Which value X, Y, Z balance the equation? So, we use inspection method or try and error method to balance this equation. So, we start with the most complex formula, which is AlF3. As we can see, there are 3 fluorine here and there are 2 fluorine here. So to make the number of fluorine same, so we need 2 times with coefficient to make both of side have 6 fluorine. So on the left side, F2 times 3. On the right side, F3 times 2. Next, we try to balance the number of aluminium. So now we have 2 aluminium on the right side and 1 aluminium on the left side. So we times aluminium with coefficient 2. So the answer would be 232, option 2. Question 4D, balance redox equation in basic medium. First, we check the oxidation number of chlorine before and after reaction. So before reaction, 2 chlorine, x equals to 0, thus x equals to 0. Okay, after reaction, chlorine in ClO4 minus 1 chlorine 1x plus 4 times oxidation number of oxygen negative 2 equals to total charge of ion negative 1. Thus, x equals to positive 7. Okay, and then chloride ion, so x equals to negative 1. Okay, so negative 1 for chloride ion and positive 7 for chlorine in ClO4 minus. Since oxidation number of chlorine increase from 0 to positive 7, so the type of reaction is oxidation. Meanwhile, when oxidation number of chlorine decrease from 0 to negative 1, the type of reaction is reduction. Okay, next divide the reaction into two half reaction of oxidation and reduction. Okay, oxidation reaction. Okay, Cl2 turns to ClO4 minus oxidation. And then Cl2 turns to chloride ion, reduction. Next, balance the atoms on both sides. We check chlorine first. Okay, so oxidation, 2 chlorine on the left side. On the right side, only 1 chlorine. So, times 2. Okay, and then reduction reaction. On the left side, 2 chlorine. On the right side, only 1. So, times 2. Okay, next, balance oxygen atom and hydrogen atom. We start with oxidation first. On the right side, there are oxygen. How many oxygen? 4 times 2. There are 8 oxygen on the right side. However, on the left side, no oxygen. So, how to add oxygen? We need to add H2O molecule. Okay, because a molecule of water consists of oxygen. How many water can be added here? Since there are less 8 oxygen, thus we need to add 8 water. Okay, now we have new problem. On the left side, there are hydrogen. On the right side, no hydrogen. So, how to add hydrogen on the right side? We add hydrogen ion. How many hydrogen ion? So, on the left side, there are 2 hydrogen times 8, 16. So, we need to add 16 hydrogen ion. Okay, settle for oxidation. Next, for reduction. Okay, luckily on reduction reaction, there are no oxygen or hydrogen. So, settle. Okay, after that, we need to balance the charge. Okay, how to balance the charge? Okay, we need to add electron. Okay, remember, oxidation substance remove electron, thus electron on the right side. Reduction substance accept electron, thus electron on the left side. Okay, next. How many electron involved? Okay, we need to study the charge. Okay, for molecule of water, neutral 0, chlorine 0. Okay, ClO4 minus, negative 1 times 2, negative 2. Okay, hydrogen ion, positive 1 times 16, positive 16. Okay, now on the left side, there are total charge 0. On the right side, 16 minus 2, 14. Okay, so how to make 14 become 0? So we need to add negative 14. Okay, so means here that mole of electron involved are 14 electron. Okay, next for reduction. Okay, so the charge of chlorine 0, the charge of chloride ion negative 1 times 2, negative 2. On the right side, negative 2. On the left side, 0. So, how to make 0 become negative 2? So, we need to add with negative 2. So, means here that Mole of electron involve 2 mole of electron. Okay, next we need to combine both half ration to get overall equation. But before we combine the ration, we need to ensure that the mole of electron are same. Okay, but now we have problem oxidation 14 mole electron, reduction 2 mole of electron. So 2 electron can become 14 electron by times with 7. Okay, so this equation times 7, we get 14 mole electron plus 7 chlorine equal to 14 chloride ion. Settle. Okay, now we can combine. Okay, so we have same species here, 14 electron, 14 electron here, thus we can cancel. Okay, next we have another same species. On the oxidation, we have Cl2. Reduction, we have Cl2 also, 7Cl2. Okay, now since the species on the same side, left side, so plus. So we just add 1 mole of fluorine with 7 mole of chlorine. Thus, the answer is 1 chlorine plus 7 chlorine, 8 chlorine. Okay, 8 water and then produce 2ClO4 minus plus 14 chloride ion plus 16 hydrogen ion. No more electron. Okay, now we already have balanced equation, but in acidic medium presence of H plus ion. We don't want H plus ion because the question asks us to balance in basic medium, which means presence of hydroxide ion. Okay, so how can we add OH minus ion? Okay, just add OH minus ion to the equation. So as we can see, on the right side of this equation, there are hydrogen ions. So we want to cancel this hydrogen ion. So we add hydroxide ion. How many hydroxide ion? Since there are 16 hydrogen ions, so we add also 16 hydroxide ion. Remember, if we add hydroxide ion on the right side of equation, on the left side also, we need to add OH minus. Okay, how many? Same number of hydroxide ion, which are 16. Okay, next. Okay, then we get new equation. HCl2 plus 8 water plus 16 OH minus forms 2ClO4 minus plus 14 Cl minus. Okay, plus 16H plus combined with 16 OH minus, the products are 16H2O. And now, as we can see, there are same species of water on the left side, 8 water, on the right side, 16 water. So same species, opposite side of equation, they will cancel one another, but in this case they will be balanced on the right side equation because 16 water is more than 8 water. Thus the new equation would be 8Cl2 plus no more water, so plus 16 OH minus produce 2ClO4 minus plus 14 Cl minus plus no more 16 H2O, but 16 minus 8 H2O. So this is the balanced redox equation in basic medium. Okay, so these are the answer. So we can simplify this equation. How? Okay, we divide this equation with 2. Thus, we get new equation. Okay, 8 chlorine becomes 4 chlorine plus 16 OH minus become 8 OH minus produce 1 ClO4 minus plus 7 Cl minus plus 4 H2O. Both equations are correct. Question 18. For the reaction equation below, calculate the mass of sodium carbonate that formed from 0.1 moles of sodium bicarbonate. Given molar mass of sodium carbonate, 83 gram per mole. Okey, jadi dalam soalan ni kita diminta untuk mencari jisim bagi sodium karbonat. Apabila kita diberikan mol sodium bikarbonat sebanyak 0.100 mol. So, we will need to do some stoichiometric calculation. Jadi, kita akan buat pengiraan stoichiometry. From the balance equation, 2 mol of sodium bicarbonate produced 1 mol of sodium carbonate. So, if we are given only 0.100 mol of sodium bicarbonate, so 0.100 over 2 times 1 get 0.05 mol of sodium carbonate. Next, from the formula, mol equals to mass over molar mass. So, to find the mass, mol times molar mass. The mol of Na2CO3 is 0.05 mol and the molar mass already given, which is 83 gram per mol. Cancel mol, the answer would be 4.15 gram. So, the answer is option 1. Question 19. The equation below is occurred at STP, standard temperature and pressure. How many moles for the reaction of calcium carbonate CaCO3 will give 22.4 centimeter cube of carbon dioxide when react with excess of HCl? Given molar volume at STP 22.4 decimeter cube. Okey, jadi dalam soalan ini kita diminta untuk mencari berapakah bilangan mol bagi reaktan CaCO3 dan kita telah diberikan maklumat tentang produk, salah satu produk CO2 yang terbentuk dengan isi padu sebanyak 22.4 centimeter cube. Kemudian kita juga diberikan maklumat semua tindak balas ini berlaku pada STP ataupun standard temperature pressure, suhu dan tekanan PRY. Ataupun berlaku pada suhu 0 darjah Celsius dan tekanan 1 atm. Kita juga diberikan maklumat bahawa HCl berlebihan. Oleh itu, HCl adalah excess reactant, reactant yang berlebihan. Maksudnya, selepas tindak balas akan ada baki. Okey, manakala CaCO3 adalah limiting reactant. So, now from the formula, okay, we are given the information about volume of the gas and we need to identify what is the mole of the substance. Okay, so from the formula to find mole equals to volume divide molar volume. In this case, molar volume at STP. So, we insert the value. Okay, volume of carbon dioxide is 22.4 divide 1000 or over exponent negative 3 to convert into unit of decimeter cube. Divide by the molar volume given 22.4 decimeter cube per mole for 1 mole of gas. Okay, decimeter cube cancel. The answer is 1 times exponent negative 3 mole of carbon dioxide. Next, we do stoichiometry. So, from the balance equation, we understand that 1 mole of carbon monoxide is produced from 1 mole of calcium carbonate. Okay, so now since we have 1 times exponent negative 3 mole of CO2, so we have same number of calcium carbonate. Because exponent negative 3 divide 1 times 1, so we get back the same value exponent negative 3. So this is the final answer, or the answer is option 4. Question 20. Magnesium reacts with hydrochloric acid according to the equation below. If 0.02 mol of magnesium powder was added to 0.02 mol HCl, calculate the amount of excess reactants remaining after the reaction. Okey, jadi dalam soalan ni kita telah diberikan maklumat amount atau jumlah bagi kedua-dua reaktan dalam tindak balas. Okey, magnesium kita diberikan maklumat tentang bilangan mol dan begitu juga untuk HCl. Okey, dan kita diminta untuk mengenal pasti siapakah excess reactant, reactant yang berlebihan dan mencari baki mol yang berlebihan. Calculate the amount tu, jadi dia minta dalam pengukuran mol. Okey. Macam mana nak tahu? Tengok option jawapan dia dalam mol. Jadi untuk soalan ni kita kena tentukan siapakah limiting reactant terlebih dahulu. Extra information. If the question give information about amounts of proposed reactants, we can use ARCT table method to identify which one is the limiting reactant. Jadi katakanlah soalan dia bagi kita maklumat tentang jumlah ataupun amount kedua-dua reactant. Jadi kita bolehlah guna kaedah ARCT untuk mengenal pasti siapakah limiting reactant dan siapakah excess reactants. Okey, penting untuk kita tentukan siapakah limiting reactant kerana limiting reactant lah yang menentukan berapa banyak excess reactant yang telah bertindak balas dan berapa banyakkah produk yang terbentuk. Jadi kalau kita nak buat stoichiometric calculation, pengiraan stoichiometri untuk kenal pasti amount excess reactant ataupun amount produk, kita kena bandingkan dengan mol limiting reactant. Okay, so first we will use ARCT method to identify which one is limiting reactant and which one is excess reactant. So we start with identify the reactant. We have two reactants, magnesium and hydrochloric acid. First step, available mol. Jadi untuk langkah yang pertama, kita kena kenal pasti mol sedia ada or given mol, mol yang telah diberikan. Okay, jadi untuk available mol, kebiasaannya akan diberikan dalam soalan. Soalan selalunya akan berikan amount kedua-dua reaktan sama ada dalam bentuk mass, molarity ataupun volume. Jadi kita boleh carilah daripada formula mol sama dengan mass over molar mass. Okay, or mol equals to molarity times volume. Okay, jadi ini sekiranya kita diberikan maklumat mass, molarity dan volume. Okey, tapi kalau dalam soalan sekarang mudah. Dah diberikan siap-siap dalam mol. Jadi tak perlu susah-susah buat pengiraan mol. Terus kita masukkan nilai mol tersebut di dalam jadual. Okey, jadi magnesium 0.02 mol, HCl 0.02 mol. Second step, required mol. Okey, langkah yang kedua kita kena mengenal pasti mol yang diperlukan. Jadi kaedahnya kita akan buat pengiraan stoichiometri perbandingan mol antara siapa? Okey, antara reaktan sahaja. Okey, so jadi kita ada dua reaktan, reaktan 1 dan reaktan 2. So kita akan compare okey, mol bagi kedua-dua reaktan tersebut. Okey, jadi contohnya sekarang untuk kolom magnesium, maksudnya kita nak cari berapakah required mol untuk magnesium, kita akan banding dengan HCl. Okey, target kita siapa? Mol magnesium, kita banding dengan HCl. Jadi ikut balance equation, 2 mol HCl react with 1 mol magnesium. So if we have available HCl 0.02 mol. Okay, so 0.02 over 2 times 1, we get 0.01 mol magnesium. So same method with HCl. So we want to identify the mole of HCl, we compare with magnesium. So from balance equation, 1 mole magnesium react with 2 mole HCl. So Available magnesium is 0.02 mol. Okay, so 0.02 over 1 times 2, we get 0.04 mol HCl. Step 3, compare mol between available versus required. Okay, jadi untuk langkah yang ketiga, kita akan bandingkan mol antara available dan required, iaitu baris pertama dan baris yang kedua. Okey, jadi contoh untuk magnesium 0.02 kita akan bandingkan dengan 0.01. Okey, jadi daripada nilai ini kita dapati 0.02 lebih daripada 0.01. Okey, 0.02 more than 0.01. Same method with HCl. Available mole is 0.02, required mole 0.04. 0.02 versus 0.04. So 0.02 less than 0.04. So the last step, type of reactant. So conclude that which one is limiting, which one is excess. Jadi untuk langkah terakhir, kita akan buat kesimpulan yang mana satukah limiting, yang mana satukah excess. Okay, jadi berdasarkan baris yang ketiga, masa kita compare mol available and reactant, kalau kita tengok available yang sedia ada lebih daripada yang diperlukan, so the type of reactant is excess reactant. If the available mol less than required. Jadi kalau kita tengok contoh untuk HCl, mol sedia ada 0.02. Yang diperlukan adalah 0.04. Jadi dia kurang ataupun tak cukup. So HCl is limiting reactants. Okay, next. Amount of excess reactant. Okay, so in mol. Okay, so jadi sekarang mudah. Kita dah kenal pasti siapakah excess reactant. Jadi kita boleh cari baki. Caranya senang saja. Available mol minus required mol. Jadi kotak pertama tolak kotak yang kedua. Okay, jadi kita akan dapat mol of excess reactant, iaitu magnesium. So bersamaan 0.02 tolak 0.01 mol. Jadi jawapan adalah 0.01 mol. Jadi kalau menggunakan kaedah tabel ni untuk cari maklumat excess reactant, senang saja. Kotak pertama tolak kotak yang kedua. Okey, maksudnya mol sedia ada, tolak dengan mol yang diperlukan, baru dapat baki. So, the answer is option 1. Question 21. An element Y belongs to the period 3 and group 2 of the periodic table. What is the number of valence electrons in each atom? Based on periodic table of elements, Y in period 3. Okay, period 1, 2, 3. Okay, here. And then group 2. Okay, group 1, group 2. Okay, here. What is the number of valence electrons? Okay, so for any elements in group 2, so they are arranged based on same number of valence electron. So in group 2, the number of valence electron are 2 valence electron. So the answer is option 2. Okay, so actually Y is magnesium. Question 22. Element X forms a chloride with formula XCl2. X would most likely be in the same group of the periodic table as. Okay, dalam soalan ni diberikan maklumat X akan bergabung dengan klorin untuk membentuk formula XCl2. Jadi soalan minta kita kenal pasti X tu dalam kumpulan yang mana dalam jadual berkala, dan kita telah diberikan pilihan sama ada sodium, magnesium, aluminium ataupun silikon. Okey, jadi kalau kita tengok kedudukan sodium dahulu. Okey, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, silikon. So oxidation number of sodium is positive 1. Okay, so sodium group 1. So sodium ion Na plus. Okay, magnesium group 2. So formula of ion magnesium 2 plus. Aluminium group 13. So formula of ion aluminium 3 plus. silicon group 14, so formula of ion silicon 4 plus. Okay, now we study the element X. So if X combine with chlorine to form XCl2, so it means that the ratio is 1:2. Tersilangkanlah nisbah tersebut 2:1. So X is positive, chlorine is negative. Jadi kalau dalam formula kimia, sebelah kiri itu adalah ion positif, sebelah kanan adalah ion negatif. Okey, jadi formula akan jadi untuk X dan chlorine tersebut ya. Okey, jadi X adalah 2 positif, chlorine adalah Cl negatif. Okey, 1 negatif ataupun kita abaikan sajalah Cl minus. Okey, jadi kalau kita tengok option jawapan, siapa yang ada oxidation number sama seperti X iaitu 2 positif? Okey, jawapannya adalah magnesium 2 plus. Okey, jadi jawapan option 2. The answer is option 2. Question 23. The following reaction has reached equilibrium. It was found to contain 0.4 molar SO3, 0.3 molar NO, 0.15 molar NO2 and 0.2 molar SO2. Calculate equilibrium constant for this reaction. Okay, jadi dalam soalan ni kita dah diberikan concentration ataupun molarity pada masa equilibrium. Okay, jadi untuk SO3 0.4, NO 0.3, NO2 0.15 molar, SO2 0.2 molar. All of these values are concentration at equilibrium. So then we can find the equilibrium constant for this reaction. Okay, so to find equilibrium constant K is equal to the ratio product over reactant. And then the concentration of each of the product or reactant power of coefficient. So the equilibrium constant K is equal to K equals to product SO3 power of coefficient 1. So no need to write. And then the second product NO power of 1. And then over or divide concentration product SO2 power of 1. Ignore the power of 1. And then the second reactant NO2 also power of 1. Okay, next we insert the value. Okay, jadi dalam soalan ni kita boleh masukkan terus molarity bagi setiap reactant dan product kerana semua nilai tersebut telah okay, sedia ada atau pada masa equilibrium. Okay, masukkan nilai SO3 0.4 kuasa 1, NO 0.3 kuasa 1 bahagi 0.2 kuasa 1 darab 0.15 kuasa 1. So the answer is 4. The answer is option 1, which is K equals to 4. Okay, sedikit peringatan, apabila kita nak cari equilibrium constant K, tak kisahlah KC ataupun KP. Okay, jadi dalam kes ni KC lah sebab kita diberikan maklumat tentang molarity atau concentration. Okey, kemudian berpandukan balance equation, kita kena rujuk coefficient bagi setiap reactant dan produk. Okey, dalam kes kita sekarang setiap reactant dan produk pemalar adalah 1. Jadi setiap reactant dan produk tu akan dikuasakan dengan 1. Question 24. The KC value for equation 1 mole of molecule I2 produce 2 mole of atom I is X at T Kelvin. At equilibrium, the following concentration were obtained. Concentration I2 0.02 molar, concentration iodine 0.01 molar. What is the X value? Okay, jadi untuk soalan ni, kita telah diberikan KC bagi equation iaitu X dan kita diminta cari apakah nilai X. Okay, maklumat yang diberikan adalah concentration pada masa equilibrium Untuk iodin 0.02 molar. Okey, itu untuk iodin molekul. Untuk atom iodin, concentration diberikan adalah 0.001 molar. Okey, jadi berdasarkan balance equation, 1 mol iodin menghasilkan 2 mol iodin atom. Okay, jadi kita boleh cari terus KC dalam soalan ni. Okey, jadi KC adalah nisbah produk bahagi reaktan dan setiap reaktan dan produk dikuasakan dengan pemalar dalam persamaan seimbang. Okey, jadi produk adalah iodin. Jadi kita ada concentration iodin kuasa 2 bahagi dengan concentration I2 kuasa 1. Okey, jadi kuasa 1 kita boleh abaikan. Nak tulis tak apa, tak nak tulis pun tak apa. Okey, jadi untuk I, molariti 0.01 molar. Untuk iodin, 0.02 molar. Final answer, 5 times exponent negative 5. So, the answer is option 4. Extra information. If the question gives information about the value of Kc or Kp, and we need to identify what is the concentration at equilibrium, and then we can use the ICE table. Jadi katakanlah soalan, kita diberikan maklumat tentang nilai Kc ataupun nilai Kp. Kemudian kita diminta untuk mengenal pasti concentration ataupun pressure pada masa equilibrium. Pada masa ini kita boleh minta bantuan ICE table. Okey, jadi I merujuk kepada initial, permulaan, starting of reaction. Jadi selalunya untuk reaktan, initial mol, okay, concentration ataupun pressure akan diberikan dalam soalan. Untuk produk, pelajar perlu faham sebelum tindak balas bermula, produk zero. Kenapa? Sebab masih belum terbentuk. Okay, seterusnya change. Change perubahan maksudnya during the reaction, semasa tindak balas kimia sedang berlaku. Jadi pelajar perlu faham bahawa reaktan akan semakin berkurang, jadi diwakilkan dengan simbol negatif. Manakala produk akan semakin bertambah. Okey, jadi diwakili simbol positif. Jadi ini berlaku untuk forward reaction ya. Tindak balas ke hadapan. Okey, jadi negatif untuk reaktan, positif untuk produk. Change berubah banyak mana tak tahu. Jadi kita wakilkan dengan simbol X unknown. Okey, jadi sekarang X tu kena ikut koefisien ya berdasarkan tindak balas kimia. Okey, jadi kalau untuk reaktan 1 1x, untuk produk 1 1x. Jadi kata lah reaktan ni 2SO2, jadi tolak 2X. Okey, contoh. Okey, next E, equilibrium. Jadi pada masa keseimbangan senang saja, initial minus change. Okey, dapatlah equilibrium. Okey, dalam bentuk unknown. So macam mana nak selesaikan unknown? Barulah kita kaitkan dengan formula Kc ataupun Kp. Okey, jadi masukkan nilai apa yang kita tahu dan unknown X, selesaikan. Kita akan dapat nilai X. Question 25. If Kc is large, that means the concentration of the what is high and therefore concentration of what is low. Okey, jadi dalam soalan ni pelajar perlu kenal pasti kepekatan bahan manakah yang tinggi dan kepekatan bahan manakah yang rendah apabila nilai Kc adalah tinggi. Jadi kita kena rujuk kepada formula Kc. Untuk cari Kc kita perlukan concentration product dikuasakan dengan pemalar dalam persamaan seimbang. Okey, bahagi dengan concentration reaktan dikuasakan dengan pemalar. Jadi kita ada nisbah produk dan reaktan di sini. Okey, apabila nilai Kc large, tinggi, ini bermaksud dari segi matematik, produk sepatutnya nilai adalah tinggi dan reaktan nilai concentration adalah rendah. Jadi kalau logik matematik, nilai yang tinggi bahagi nilai yang kecil akan dapat nilai K yang tinggi. Jadi jawapannya adalah concentration high product. Okey, concentration low reactant. Option 3. Question 26. Consider the diagram below. At what time the reaction reach equilibrium? Jadi pelajar perlu rujuk graf di bawah dan mengenal pasti pada masa bilakah sistem telah mencapai keseimbangan. So now we study an example. Let's say we have a reaction for decomposition of N2O4 into NO2. Jadi contoh kita ada tindak balas penguraian N2O4 kepada NO2. So based on the graph of concentration versus time, the amounts of reactant which is N2O4 decrease. Okay, because formation of product NO2. Okay, so jadi kalau kita tengok line yang menurun ni merujuk kepada jumlah reaktan yang semakin berkurang, manakala line yang semakin lengkung yang menaik ini merujuk kepada jumlah produk yang semakin bertambah. Okey, pada satu tahap, kedua-dua line atau garisan tersebut menjadi satu garisan yang lurus ataupun horizontal line. Okey, jadi pada masa T tersebut, sebenarnya sistem telah mencapai keseimbangan. So, remember, when system if equilibrium, it has two characteristics. The first one, the rate of forward reaction equals to the rate of reverse reaction. And then the concentration of reactant or product remain constant or unchanged. Jadi, pelajar perlu ingat bahawa dua ciri keseimbangan kimia. Pertama adalah kadar tindak balas kehadapan adalah sama dengan kadar tindak balas ke belakang. Okey, kedua, kepekatan reaktan dan produk adalah kekal, tidak berubah sepanjang keseimbangan dicapai. Okey, jadi kita rujuk semula graf yang diberikan. Memandangkan garisan lurus bagi A, B dan C bermula pada masa T3. Oleh itu, T3 adalah masa di mana sistem telah mencapai keseimbangan. Question 27. What is the unit for the rate constant K for a second order reaction? Apakah unit bagi pemalar kadar K bagi tertib tindak balas kedua? So we have three types of order of reaction. For zero order, the rate of reaction independent to the concentration of reactant A. Jadi untuk zero order, kadar tindak balas tidak bergantung kepada kepekatan bahan. Contoh, bahan reaktan A, concentration rendah ataupun tinggi tidak mempengaruhi kadar tindak balas. Okay, so the rate law is equals to the rate equals to K times concentration reaktan A power of 0. So, rate equals to K. Jadi, concentration A kuasa kosong dapat 1. 1 darab K sama dengan K. Okay. Next, first order reaction. For the first order reaction, the rate of reaction is depend on the concentration of A. Jadi untuk first order, kadar tindak balas bergantung kepada kepekatan bahan. Okey, jadi rate law adalah rate equals to K times concentration reactant A power of 1. Jadi kuasa 1 dapatlah rate equals to K times concentration A. Okay, for second order reaction, rate of reaction depend on the concentration of reactant A power of 2. Untuk second order, kadar tindak balas bergantung kepada kepekatan bahan reactant A sebanyak kuasa 2. Okay, jadi rate law, rate equals to K times concentration A power of 2. Okay, so next, since the formula of rate is change in concentration of reactant or product over change in time, the unit of concentration is M and the unit of time can be in second, minute, hour, day, months or year. So, the unit commonly molar per second. Okay, jadi unit rate adalah molar per time. Masa tu tak kisahlah dalam saat, minit, jam, hari, bulan atau tahun. Okey, sekarang contoh kalau kita kira ataupun nak tahu unit untuk zero order. Jadi senang saja untuk zero order kita tahu K adalah rate. Unit rate adalah molar per second. Jadi, molar per second itu adalah unit untuk zero order. Okey, untuk first order reaction, katalah kita nak cari unit untuk K. Jadi, dia adalah rate bahagi dengan concentration A power of 1, tak perlu tulislah. Jadi molar per second bahagi dengan M dapatlah unit per second. Jadi untuk first order, unit adalah per second ataupun per time. Untuk unit K bagi second order sama dengan rate bahagi dengan concentration A power of 2. Jadi rate adalah molar per time ataupun per second. Okay, and then concentration M power of 2. So the unit of K is M negative 1 S negative 1. So the unit for second order of reaction is per molar per second. Question 28. Predict the rate law of the following reaction based on the data given below. Okay, jadi untuk soalan ni, pelajar perlu kenal pasti rate law ataupun rate equation berdasarkan data eksperimen yang diberikan. So, we have experiment 1, experiment 2, experiment 3. Jadi kita akan bandingkan rate law bagi ketiga-tiga eksperimen tersebut. We start with write the expression for rate equation or rate law. Rate equals to K times concentration reactant. So now we have two reactants. Reactant A and reactant B. And then power of order of reaction. Okay, jadi kita nak kuasakan order of reaction. Kalau tengok dalam soalan, tak diberikan dan kita perlu cari. Okey, jadi di sini ada peringatan, jangan sesekali kuasakan dengan pemalar dalam keseimbangan. Okey, jangan. Okey, kenapa? Coefficient not equals to the order of reaction. Okey, pemalar dalam persamaan seimbang tidak sama dengan tertib tindak balas. Okey, remember order of reaction is given from the experimental data. Jadi ingat, order hanya boleh diketahui menerusi data eksperimen sahaja, bukan dalam persamaan seimbang. Okay, jadi memandangkan kita tak tahu, kita wakilkan dengan unknown. Contoh, concentration A power of X, concentration B power of Y. Jadi kita akan selesaikanlah what is X, what is Y. Kita akan manipulasi data dalam jadual ini. Okay, so to solve the X, we need to have same concentration of Y. Okay, jadi untuk selesaikan X, kita kena tengok jadual. Concentration Y yang sama. Jadi, kita tengok untuk tertib Y atau concentration B, kita boleh dapatkan daripada eksperimen 1 dan eksperimen 2. Okey, seterusnya kita akan buat perbandingan rate law eksperimen 1 bagi rate law eksperimen 2. Okey, jadi eksperimen 1 rate adalah X, eksperimen 2 rate adalah 2X. Okey, K darab dengan concentration A 0.1 kuasa X, 0.1 kuasa Y. Bahagi K darab 0.2 darab X, 0.1 darab Y. X bahagi X dapat 1/2. K bahagi K dapat 1. 0.1 kuasa Y bahagi 0.1 kuasa Y dapat 1. So 0.1 bahagi 0.2 dapat 0.5 kuasa X. Okey, seterusnya kita selesaikan. Okey, 1/2 sum. Okey, 0.5 sebenarnya adalah 1/2 kuasa X. Dekat sini kita dah boleh selesaikanlah. Sebenarnya X adalah kuasa 1. Okey, next nak selesaikan Y. Jadi kita akan tengok nilai yang sama bagi concentration A. Jadi eksperimen 1 dan eksperimen 3. Okey, so rate 1 divide rate 3 equals to rate 1 X, rate 3 4 X. Okay, so just insert the value. Okay, so X over X equals to 1. So we get 1 over 4 here. K over K equals 1. 0.1X divide by 0.1 power of X equals to 1. So equals to 0.5 power of Y. So 0.5 is equals to 1 over 2 power of Y. So 1 over 4 actually is 1 over 2 power of 2. So y equals to 2. So the rate law is k times concentration A power of order x, which is 1, times concentration reactant B power of order y, which is 2. Okay, so rate equals to k concentration A times concentration B power of 2. The answer is option 2. Question 29. A substance P changes by first order reaction according to the following equation: P produce Q and W. Which statement about effect of particle size of P is correct? Jadi, untuk soalan ni, pelajar perlu mengenal pasti pernyataan yang benar tentang faktor yang mempengaruhi kadar tindak balas dari segi saiz zarah. There are four factors that affect the rate of reaction. Terdapat empat faktor yang mempengaruhi kadar tindak balas. Temperature, suhu, catalyst, pemangkin, concentration or pressure, concentration, kepekatan larutan aqueous ataupun gas, pressure, tekanan gas sahaja. Particle size, size zarah, temperature factor. Let's say under higher temperature or hot condition, more molecules gain or have higher kinetic energy, and this will increase the frequency of collisions and the number of effective collisions, so the rate of reaction also increase. Catalyst factor. Catalyst increase the rate of reaction by lowering activation energy. Concentration or pressure factor. At higher concentration, there will be more molecules per unit volume. More molecules increase the number of effective collision, so the rate of reaction will increase. So the same case happens for situation under higher pressure. Particle size factor. So the molecule big or small will affect the rate of reaction. So bigger molecule has lower surface area and smaller molecule has larger or greater surface area. Greater surface area, they will increase in number of effective collision, thus the rate of reaction also increased. Okay, first, rate of reaction increase when particle size of P is bigger. So rate increase, size bigger is incorrect because when P is bigger, it has lower surface area and lower the rate of reaction. Okay, second, kinetic energy of particles P decrease when temperature increase. Incorrect because when temperature increase or under hot condition, the particles P will absorb the heat energy and it will have more kinetic energy. So this answer incorrect. Okay, the third one. The smaller size of particles P increase the quantity of effective collision. So this statement is correct because smaller particle has greater surface area and there will be increase in number of effective collision. Jadi kalau untuk zarah yang bersaiz kecil, dia lagi banyak permukaan yang terdedah untuk tindak balas. Okey, oleh itu surface area ataupun nya meningkat, jadi possibility untuk berlanggar antara satu sama lain pun meningkat. Jadi pelanggaran berkesan pun boleh berlaku, lebih banyak produk yang terbentuk, jadi kadar tindak balas akan semakin meningkat. The last one, the smaller size of particle, the lower total surface area exposed for reaction. So this one incorrect because the smaller molecule or particle, it has greater surface area. Okay, jadi, lagi kecil suatu molekul, lagi luas permukaan bersentuhan untuk tindak balas berlaku. So, the answer is option 3. Question 30. Rate formation of oxygen is 1.5 molar per minute. determine the rate formation of water. Okay, jadi untuk soalan ini, pelajar telah diberikan rate bagi oksigen. Dan kita perlu cari rate untuk water. Okay, jadi kalau ikut tindak balas ni, kita ada reaktan hydrogen peroxide H2O2 dan produk ada dua, water dan oksigen. Okay, koefisien pemalar untuk reaktan, tumol. Okay, untuk produk, water, tumol, untuk oksigen, 1 mol. Okay, so from the question, we are given the rate formation of oxygen. Okay, formation, pembentukan. Okay, maksudnya diwakili simbol positif. Okay, jadi rate adalah perubahan concentration bahagi dengan perubahan masa. Okay, jadi concentration oksigen. Okay, dan dia dah bagi 1.5 molar per minit. Okay, ini given in question yang diberikan dalam soalan. Okay, next we write the full expression for differential rate equation. So, differential rate equation rate equals to remember during a reaction, amount of reactant decrease, amount of product increase. Jadi, apabila tindak balas berlaku, jumlah reactant akan berkurang manakala jumlah produk akan bertambah. Okay, reactant berkurang diwakili dengan simbol negatif. Reactant adalah H2O2. Okay, dia akan berkurang dengan masa. Okay, untuk produk, okay, dan satu lagi, satu per koefisien. Jadi, kalau kita tengok di sini, koefisien adalah 2. Oleh itu, 1 bahagi koefisien 2. Next, produk. Produk increase. So, positive 1 over koefisien of water, 1 over 2. So, D concentration water over DT. Okay, equals to positive 1 over 1 for oxygen, no need to write. So, D concentration oxygen over DT. Okay, so now we are given information about oxygen. And then we want to find rate for water. So, we compare the differential equation between water and oxygen only. Okay, jadi kalau saya, perkara yang kita nak cari tu selalunya kita letak sebelah kiri. Okay, jadi kita nak cari apa? H2O. So, kita tulis dulu expression untuk water, H2O. Okay, kita bandingkan dengan yang telah diberikan kepada kita. Okay, so kita hanya nak positif D H2O over DT sahaja. Jadi, 1/2 tak nak, kita bawa ke sebelah kanan. So, the answer is option number 4. Okay, 3 molar per minute. Sekian sahaja perbincangan untuk kali ini. Semoga semua pelajar diberikan kesihatan yang baik, dipermudahkan urusan menjawab peperiksaan dan mendapat keputusan yang cemerlang dalam semua subjek, terutamanya subjek kimia TK014. All the best. Good luck.